As I record this, it's the second week of October, and where I live in the Pacific Northwest, the days are getting shorter, and it's getting colder and crisper in the air, and I've seen a lot of beautiful fall colors on my morning and afternoon commute. And it's days like this where I just want to stay home and curl up in bed with a cup of alpine apple cider and a really good book to read, and for me, those are classics. In this episode, I wanted to talk about some of the creepiest classics that I have read. Keep in mind, my threshold for scary stories is not that high, so you're not going to find anything here that's especially horrifying or terrifying. But I've come across a number of stories, particularly Victorian short stories, that have given me the creeps or otherwise spooked me out. I think a lot of us tend to read spooky stories this time of year with Halloween coming up. I don't personally celebrate Halloween, but it's just part of our culture. And one of my family's traditions is we get around the TV and watch The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, the 1949 Disney cartoon musical. I've enjoyed that one since I was a small child. It stars Bing Crosby playing the voice of the school teacher Ichabod Crane and his nemesis Bram Bones, who is out to prank him. And it's just a really fun story. If you can find it on DVD or on Amazon, I definitely recommend it if you just want to watch something kind of fun and lighthearted, but also a little spooky. I did read The Legend of Sleepy Hollow once, and I didn't find it to be all that scary. I didn't actually find Ichabod to be very likable either. In Washington Irving's original short story, I find Ichabod to be kind of egotistical and materialistic, and not the likable, pitiful, naive schoolteacher in the musical cartoon. And additionally, Bram Bones doesn't seem as bad in the book. He seems more like just a prankster, whereas in the movie he seems kind of bad, and interestingly he looks a lot like Gaston from Beauty and the Beast, so that's an instant turnoff, right? But while it's kind of a fun one for the season, it's not really creepy to me, not even the original story. I didn't find it to be very creepy. So I'm going to go over some that are mostly from the Victorian era, and one or two Edwardian stories. And these are stories I've read over the past decade or two, and ones that really stuck out to me. So let's start with Bram Stoker. Bram Stoker, of course, being famous for perhaps the most famous creepy Victorian story of all, Dracula, he wrote a short story called Dracula's Guest. Dracula's Guest was published posthumously after Stoker's death by his wife, and they're not really sure exactly where it fits in the Dracula universe, so to speak. It may or may not have been part of the original Dracula manuscript. There's a lot of similarities, though, so it might have been something he decided to cut out to make the book shorter. But it's very similar in mood to the original Dracula. Dracula's Guest is about an Englishman who takes a walk and wanders into a cemetery. This is all in a foreign land, in this case, not Transylvania, but in Germany. And of course, when he wanders into the cemetery, it's getting dark, and you can imagine what happens from there. It's definitely a spooky story, especially since it's a standalone one, and it's got a lot of the motifs from Dracula, like the wolves. You don't have some of the other ensemble characters, like Van Helsing or Mina, to offset the sense of isolation around the main character. And the main character, I don't think he's named, but he's presumably Jonathan Harker, the protagonist from Dracula. So if you enjoyed Dracula, or you just sort of want to get an idea of what Dracula's like without reading the entire novel, I think Dracula's Guest is a good one to read, and I guarantee you it will kind of spook you out. Number 8 on my list is another one by Bram Stoker, a little bit lesser known, and it's called The Crooked Sands. This story actually starts out as a comedy. It's about this Englishman, another Englishman, who takes his family on vacation to Scotland. And he has this great hankering to dress up as a Scottish Highlander with the kilt and everything. And he decides to pursue this idea of his, and he completely embarrasses his family. Things get a little weirder when he is walking around on the beach and he sees another person there who is dressed up exactly like him. From there, it just gets even more bizarre. So this one is a very creative story and very eerie, and I think it's well worth reading, especially for the contrast you get between the humor and the spookiness. The Crooked Sands by Bram Stoker, an underrated short story. Let's see. So the next two are by one of my favorite authors of short stories, and that is H.G. Wells. I'm actually reading a collection by him right now called The Country of the Blind and Other Stories. He's, of course, most famous for The Time Machine and The War of the Worlds, The Invisible Man, and The Island of Dr. Moreau. And those are all great science fiction novels, but I find his short stories to be very effective as well. I think he was very good at packing a lot of punch into the short form and giving you a sense of having read something and feeling satisfied with a short story. So if you haven't tried any of his short stories, and if you like the Victorian style, then I think you would enjoy them. The first one I want to talk about is called In the Avu Observatory. And this one, sort of like The Crooked Sands, isn't exactly a horror story or even a ghost story, but it's a little bit eerie. And it's about a scientist who's alone in this observatory. He's getting ready for a boring watch. He's supposed to be watching the stars. And he's planning to sit there for hours and hours with his eyes glued to the telescope. But he starts seeing and hearing things, and he realizes he's not alone in the observatory. This is one of those stories that I've read two or three times now. Every time I come to it, I just can't stop myself from reading it. It's not that it's that scary, but it just is, again, a very satisfying story, and I recommend it for sure. Another one that I can hardly pass by when I read H.G. Wells' stories is called The Flowering of the Strange Orchid. I recently wrote a blog post about orchids, and it was when I was listening to an audiobook. It was called About Orchids, and it was by this journalist named Frederick Boyle, and it was also Victorian. So he was talking about the history of orchids and different types of orchids and his enthusiasm for growing orchids. And I've been personally interested in orchids ever since I read this H.G. Wells short story. And it's kind of funny because it is a scary story. It's about this guy named Winter Wedderburn. And Winter Wedderburn is an orchid collector and a generally bored person. He doesn't have any family. He lives with his housekeeper. His biggest excitement in his life is going to an orchid sale and seeing what kind of interesting plants he can buy for a good deal, and whether any of them will bloom and turn into something brand new. Because back then, and this is something I learned in Frederick Boyle's book, is that orchids were still fairly new, and people would go to a sale and very well buy a brand new species that hadn't been identified yet or named. So Winter Wedderburn goes to an orchid sale, and he does find a very unusual specimen, but his housekeeper doesn't like the look of it at all, and it turns out to bode very ill for Winter Wedderburn. I won't say anything more without giving it away, but again, this is a very creative story, and one that I love to reread from time to time. It didn't stop me from getting into orchids. In fact, I have two orchids now and going to be going the route of Winter Wedderburn here pretty soon if I'm not careful. Okay, now we come to one of H.G. Wells' contemporaries and one of the authors that I teased in the title. And this is, of course, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. About over 10 years ago now, I think, I was in this Sir Arthur Conan Doyle phase, and I read a lot of his works, not just Sherlock Holmes, but his lesser-known series like Brigadier Gerard and the Professor Challenger science fiction novels. And I also discovered his short stories, a number of which are quite spooky, sort of like Sherlock Holmes. One of those stories that stuck with me is called Lot Number 249, and this was published in 1892. Lot number 249 takes place at Oxford, and it's about this student named Edward Bellingham. And Edward Bellingham has a beloved mummy, And by mummy, I don't mean mother, but he has an actual Egyptian mummy in a sarcophagus. What makes this kind of weird is that Bellingham is not a very nice person, and he makes some enemies at college, and he decides to wreak revenge on them in a very terrifying way. I only wish that this story had been adapted for film and put on DVD. It was adapted in a 1967 BBC TV episode produced by John Hawksworth, who is famous for Upstairs, Downstairs, and also the Granada TV series Sherlock Holmes, which is my favorite Sherlock Holmes adaptation. But this Lot 249, I could not find it online to watch, which is a real shame because it's got a lot of cinematic elements in it, not the least of which is Edward Bellingham's mummy. So I hope to find this video someday. If you know where to watch it, let me know. But until then, I do recommend the short story, and I think that it's a very underrated Sir Arthur Conan Doyle short story. The next three I want to talk about are from the Sherlock Holmes series itself. First one's called The Copper Beeches. It's part of the Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, and it's about a young woman named Violet Hunter who is looking for a job as a governess, and she finds a position that's going to pay very, very well, but she has some hesitations. The employer is a jovial old gentleman, very jovial in fact, very inclined to laugh and have a good joke, and this gentleman's wife, they're both kind of a quirky couple, and they have a strange list of requirements for the governess that they're looking for. And at one point, they ask Violet Hunter to cut her hair, and she really wants to take this job, but she just has a bad gut feeling about it. So she comes to Sherlock Holmes and asks for advice. And Holmes, of course, picks up on the scent that there is something sinister going on here. This is one of my favorite Sherlock Holmes stories, for sure. I think I just really connect to Violet Hunter, the character. She's one of the strongest female characters in the whole series. I read somewhere long ago that Doyle's mother came up with the idea for this story, or at least part of the story, and I have not been able to find that the source for that, so I'm not sure if it's true. But in any case, Violet Hunter is a great character. Interestingly enough, if you read to the end, Watson actually says that he wished Sherlock Holmes would get together with Violet Hunter. I thought that's kind of funny. Most people think that Irene Adler from A Scandal in Bohemia is Sherlock Holmes's romantic interest, but actually Violet Hunter is closer to that role. But in any case, it doesn't turn out that way. It's a very eerie story and full of suspense. There's also a great adaptation starring Jeremy Brett and David Burke. That's that Granada TV series I mentioned a moment ago, so I highly recommend that episode as well. The next Sherlock Holmes story I distinctly remember reading at night and being pretty scared. Granted, I was a child when I read it, but it left quite an impression on me. It's called The Greek Interpreter. And this one comes from the memoirs of Sherlock Holmes. In this story, we meet Mycroft Holmes, Sherlock Holmes' older brother, for the first time. But it really features this character named Mr. Melas. And he is a Greek interpreter who is for hire and often gets called away at odd hours to meet people. But one night, he gets taken away in this cab with the blinds drawn down. And he ends up at this house and meets a few other people there, and then realizes he's been asked to take place in an interrogation of this Greek man who's held captive in that house. I won't give anything away, but this is definitely one of the darker Sherlock Holmes stories, and I found it to be absolutely chilling. The illustrations are haunting, the illustrations by Sidney Paget, and again, there's a great film adaptation with Jeremy Brett, which I think is very true to the story, and adds its own take on the ending, which I thought was very effective. The last Sherlock Holmes story I wanted to talk about is called The Devil's Foot, and this one is Edwardian. It's from 1910, and it takes place on the Cornish coastline. It's about this man who comes to Sherlock Holmes and tells him that He had been visiting his two brothers and sister one night, but the next morning he came back, he found them exactly where he had left them. But the two brothers had gone insane, and the sister was dead. This, again, was a very dark story, but also very creative. I think this is one that's fairly unique in the entire series, especially the way Sherlock Holmes goes about solving it. So if you haven't read this one, I think it's a must-read Sherlock Holmes story. Yes, there is a TV adaptation of it, and that is also very scary, and it creeps me out every time I see it. So yes, if you're looking for a very unsettling short story, then The Devil's Foot by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. We've gone through 8 short stories and covered several different authors. The author I wanted to finish with is Charlotte Perkins Gilman and her story from 1892, and it's called The Yellow Wallpaper. My sister was assigned this in English class, and I decided to read it at the same time since it hadn't been assigned to me, but I was curious. I thought this was borderline horrifying. It's about this woman who suffers from depression and is prescribed a rest cure. And by a rest cure, they meant you were supposed to take it easy and not do anything, not even think or read or write, just totally rest. And apparently Charlotte Perkins Gilman was prescribed that once, so this story is in part a memoir, but it's also got its fanciful side because this woman, along with her husband, goes to spend the summer at this mansion and she's on this rest cure. And they stay in this room, which is an old nursery with barred windows and very derelict yellow wallpaper that looks like it's been utterly abused. And this woman starts to see things in that room. And so let me tell you, I don't recommend reading this one at night. I don't remember when I read it, but it was one of those that I kind of wish I hadn't read after I read it. It's very spooky, but it's also a commentary on the way doctors approached mental health issues back then. And again, Gilman was writing from a certain amount of personal experience, so it's half horror story and half memoir. I think it's probably the spookiest Victorian story I've read, and certainly up there with stories by Edgar Allan Poe, whom I did not include in this, but I probably should dedicate a whole episode to Poe. Those are 9 stories to keep you busy this month, and let me know if you end up reading any of them, or if you have any Victorian short stories to recommend.